storm surrounding me, let it break. At your name, still call the sea to still, the rage in me to still, every wave. At your name, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, your silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, breathe, call these bones to live, and call these lungs to sing once again. I will praise Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, your silence fair. And Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus. And Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, your silence fair. And Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is a light that the shadows
is Maddie Picasso. Used to be Maddie Hill. Can you believe a voice like that has anything to do with T. Hill? That's unbelievable. Thank God for Lori Hill. So anyhow, yeah, let's give the Lord a hand again. Amen. That's David says she's singing for two, okay? And so can you imagine that baby? I bet that baby was just rocking out in there, having a great time. So Hey, listen, I want to welcome you this morning to the Ridge Church. So excited that you're here. We've got a great, great day. I mean, it's always a great day here, but I'm telling you, exceptionally excited about today. I want to begin, though, by saying if you're a first-time guest, hopefully you grabbed a bulletin on the way in the door. And if you'll open that bulletin, look all the way over at the far right-hand side, you'll see a little area you can fold and tear. That's a guest card. We'd love to know that you're here. You can turn that in a couple of ways. Either you can drop it in the offering box on the way out the door. Say it every week. We mean it every week. We ask if you're a first-time guest, that would be the only thing you would drop in the offering box, because you have already brought the greatest treasure today. That's you. And just trusting us to hang out with us this morning means the world to us. So thank you for being here. You can also turn it in at the welcome counter, information booth right across the lobby here. We have a gift we'd love to exchange. And just love to know that you are here. Hey, we're going to celebrate this morning with baptism, the Lord's Supper, just so many things going on today. Have a special guest that's going to be coming to share that was a recipient of a shoebox, Operation Christmas Child shoebox whenever she was an eight-year-old. Just going to be an exciting, exciting time. So right now, Roger's going to baptize two people.
All right. Always a thrill when someone follows the Lord in baptism. I always think of Jesus taking that initial step of baptism and the Father speaking, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." There's something about taking this step that, again, just kind of tells everyone my old life is buried, that God's given me new life because Christ has come to live in my heart. It really is a great celebration. So we're going to baptize Angie and Colin today, and so I always like to take a minute and just pray for each one. So would you join me as we pray for Angie? Father, thank you so much for Angie. I just thank you, Lord, for her taking this step, and Lord, her just publicly wanting to declare that she is following you with her heart. So, Lord, just bless her today. I pray this would be the first of many steps and acts of obedience. Fill her with your Spirit. I pray you would love on her in a special way. In Jesus' name, amen. Angie, believe that Jesus has forgiven you of your sin and come into your heart as Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Then upon your profession of faith and upon the command of the Lord Jesus Christ, it's an honor today to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Good job.
We have Colin, 17 years old. We appreciate Colin. Watch that step. Yeah. It's slippery. All right, let's take a minute and pray for Colin. Father, thank you for this young man. I just thank you, Lord, for his desire to just declare his love for you. I thank you at a young age, Lord, he's taken this stand. I just pray that you would use his life as a testimony of your grace and your faithfulness. So, Father, we just speak peace and blessing to him. Father, love on him in a special way today as he takes this step. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Colin, you believe Jesus has come into your heart and forgiven you of your sin? Upon your profession of faith and upon the command of the Lord Jesus Christ, it's a privilege today to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Good job, man.
Proud of you, buddy. God bless you.
So, Helen, come on down. Can we give a hand to Helen Clabunde? This is, yeah. We've got some fans out there. Okay. This is Tim and Dina Clabunde's daughter. See, it was really cool. I said, "How old are you?" She said, "Well, next month's my birthday, but I'm 7. So she wanted me to know she's almost 8. I do that, only reverse. They say, "How old are you?" I say, "I'm almost 58. They think I'm 57, but I'm 59, but I'm almost 58. I was just 58 last June, okay? So, but anyhow, she's looking forward, all right? So, but I asked her story, and whenever she was 5 years old, she'd been asking a lot of questions already for quite a while, and she said I could share this story. She said, "I kind of got in trouble, and I went to my mom and dad and said, I need forgiveness of that." And they knew, Tim and Dina knew, she was beginning to process sin, and we need forgiveness. And so not long after that, at age 5, she committed to Christ. Mom and dad said, "We just want to make sure she really embraced it before she was baptized." So here she is, 7, almost 8, being baptized. Aren't you proud of her? Can we give the Lord a hand again for Helen? Amen. So, Helen, I want to ask you a couple of questions here, okay? I'm going to move this. You're just fine right there. I want to make sure. There we go. So, have you given your heart and life to Jesus?
Yes.
And are you trusting Jesus and Jesus only to get you to heaven?
Yes.
Amen. Then Helen, because you just told everybody in this room, she's ready, isn't she? She's already getting ready to pinch, okay? Because you've already told everybody in this room, and look at them, just look at them. This is your family. You're ours, and we're yours, and we're so proud of you. You've told everybody in this room that you belong to Jesus, and Jesus commands us to be baptized. You want to be obedient to him?
Mm-hmm.
It is my privilege, my sister, my little sister, to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. You can go that way. Woo. Amen.
Tessie.
Hi, my name is Lynn Mall, and I am a regional area coordinator for Operation Christmas Child, and I'm also a member of this church. And I'm just so happy that this church has been packing shoebox gifts for many years. And this year, our goal is 1,000 shoebox gifts to send out to children all over the world. Operation Christmas Child will be sending out boxes to over 100 countries this year. And each box is just a special joy for the children to receive. And not only is it a joy that's filled with hope and fun, but it's also an opportunity to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so Elena is going to come and share with you her story of how she received a shoebox as a child.
Hello. Hi. So my name is Elena, and I'm originally from former Soviet Union. My biological name is Petrova Yelena Vladimirovna. Let's all say that three times. Oh, wishful thinking. So I grew up in the former Soviet Union with my sister Yulia. We're about 2 years apart. And where we grew up, it was basically a very small town in a very small house in a very broken house, in the sense that we had a lot of broken windows and we could not fix them because of how poor my family was. And my parents, they would go off and they would work all day long, but they would never get paid with food or money. They would actually get paid with alcohol. So while they were off working, it was my responsibility as the oldest to try to take care of myself and my sister. And so each morning, we would get up and we would look for food in our kitchen and our drawers and just anywhere where we can think of. And the only thing we would find was alcohol bottles. So the next logical thing for me was to actually go outside and see what we could find in the nature. And I remember when my sister and I, we were just very, very hungry, that we would actually climb trees and we would eat the leaves off of those trees just so we could have something in our stomachs. And every night you could feel the darkness coming over our house, because what that meant was my parents coming home after days of work, days of drinking. They were coming home and my dad was completely drunk. And when he became very drunk, he became very abusive. And so each night he would come home and whatever his hand touched is what he was going to use on my mom that night. Firewood, fire pokers, ropes, whatever you guys can imagine. And when I was about 8 years old, my parents were caught stealing some items, and so they were put into prison, and myself and my sister, we were put into an orphanage. And truthfully, this first orphanage was basically a safe haven for me and my sister, because at this orphanage, they provided us with three things that we really needed. One of those things, just being able to go to school. So I loved going to school. I loved feeling like a normal kid who got to learn new things each and every day. That was amazing. The second thing was just having someone at the orphanage as an adult, as a caregiver, to help me to raise my sister. Because if you think about it, by the age of 8, I was her mom, I was her dad, I was her sister, I was her friend, I was her protector, I was her provider. And that is just a lot of responsibilities to have for an 8-year-old. So just having someone there 24/7 to help me to raise my sister, that helped me a lot. And the third thing, which was my favorite thing, was just the fact that they provided us with three meals a day. And like I said, we hardly had one meal a day at the house, so having three meals a day, for me anyways, was like heaven, because I don't know about you guys, but I enjoy food, okay? And so having three meals a day and snacks in between, it was amazing. And we stayed at this orphanage for about 2 years. And then after those 2 years, we were moved to our second orphanage. And again, we had caregivers, we had a school, we had food. But the thing that we did not have was love, joy, or hope for the future. Truthfully, as an orphan girl, the future that I had to look forward to was basically selling my body so I could put some food on my on the table for me and my sister. That was my future, that was my sister's future. So truthfully, as an orphan girl, I had no future to look forward to. I had no hope. And so growing up at this orphanage, when I was at my lowest point, when I felt the most unloved, when I felt the most unwanted, that is when God provided us a shoebox filled with toys. And for me and my sister, receiving a shoebox filled with items, that was a miracle in itself, because until that point, we have never received a gift before. We didn't celebrate birthdays or Christmas or anything like that. And so when I got my shoebox was amazing. Okay, it was wrapped in a colorful wrapping paper. It was bright. It was shining. It was the coolest thing I have ever seen. Until I opened it. And when I opened it, my shoebox was glowing pink from the inside out. And for a lot of it is like, oh, pink, no big deal. But for me, that was a huge deal because I love color pink. And the cool thing about it is the fact that God knew that about me before I even knew that about myself. And so he gave me a shoebox of color pink. And I had some socks in that shoebox. They were amazing. They were pink. I had a teddy bear. He was pink. He was amazing. Named him Teddy. Very original, I know. I actually had a Barbie with a pink glowy gown that she had on. She was beautiful. I had all of these things in my shoebox, everything pink, and I loved every one of those items. One of the coolest things I got was a pen similar to this. This is not the pen, but it's similar, and so I want to show you guys how cool my pen was. So my pen was a little bit taller. It had the fluffies, and then there was a wire, and the heart would dingle on it. You guys seen those, right? Well, I didn't see one of those until I got one of those. And let me tell you, I was fascinated by that pen. And I loved it. I hit my sister a few times with the heart, you know. Don't do that, that's bad. But I did it. I loved it. And then I had the greatest idea. I was like, I wonder if the ink of my pen is pink as well. And as I press down, the heart lights up. And I went ballistic. I was like, guys, drop everything. Look at my pen. I was the popular kid for like 5 minutes because of a pen like this. And I loved it. I loved everything in my box, but the thing that I loved the most was the fact that somebody took up their time and packed a gift for me. When I felt like a nobody, when I felt unloved, when I felt like I was just there to take up space, somebody was telling me, you are somebody. I took up my time. I went shopping, I packed, and I sent it off. Somebody. And you're that somebody. And so that was the first time I felt like I was being loved by someone, and that someone was a stranger that I have never even met. And that felt good. That love felt really, really good. And the coolest thing is actually this little booklet that I got on top of my box. And usually, if you guys don't know this, when kids receive your shoeboxes in the other countries, they get the shoebox and then they get this booklet in their native language on top of a shoebox. So they can look at it, they can read it. And that's the coolest thing for us, because when I read this booklet, it's the greatest gift. I read it and I thought it was a fairy tale. Because this booklet was telling me about Jesus. And it was the first time I heard his name. It was the first time I got to read what he has done for me. And I read this booklet and I thought it was a fairy tale, because this booklet was telling me that there was a creator of everything who came down and died for me. Not because I've done something amazing, not because I was very popular. He did that because he loved me. And because I did not know that kind of love, I could not wrap my mind around that kind of love. And so I thought this booklet was a fairy tale. I thought it was too good to be true. But because I had nothing else to hold on to, no other hope to hold on to, this booklet became that hope. And I actually started to pray to God for a family that would want me and my sister together, because we were basically a package deal. And let me tell you, in 2004, he provided that family. And I guess I didn't pray clearly enough, because now I have two younger brothers as well. But no, I love them. And God has blessed me, and he used a small shoebox to change my life. And so I'm here today to basically say thank you from the bottom of my heart for packing these shoeboxes and just kind of being an encouragement, in the sense that sometimes we feel like, oh, it's just a shoebox filled with pink or orange colors or whatever. But for us who have nothing, for us who feel like we have no one, for us to get a shoebox from you guys filled with all the items that we get, we love all of those. But we love the fact that you packed, because we get to feel love from you guys. And more than that, you guys tell us, when we feel like we have no one in our corner, you telling us that our Heavenly Father is in our corner fighting for us each and every day. And that is the greatest gift you guys give to these kids. So thank you so much for packing and being the hands and feet of Jesus to these kids. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Elena. That's a great testimony, and it inspires each of us maybe to give a little bit more to the shoeboxes. So. We're going to sing a song that it's kind of an oldie by now, but it's called "We Want to See Jesus Lifted High." And when we get to the chorus, we want you to do a special thing for us, because it goes... How does it go? We want to see Jesus lifted high. I know you can do it. I know you can do it. Even the 8 o'clock service could do it, so I'm sure you could do it. Because they're half asleep like me. All right, let's stand together as we worship. right out of Scripture.
He became sin who knew no sin, that we might be called His righteousness. He humbled Himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so
under earth or heaven where a man can be saved but the name of Jesus.
Oh,
give God a hand. Be seated.
Good to see everybody. And this morning, we're going to finish our series on the names of God. Next week, we start a series on Come to the Table. Come to the Table. You know, it's amazing how many things happened around a table in the Bible. And so we're going to talk about that. And one day, we're going to gather around the table up in heaven for that supper up in heaven. We're excited about that. I want to, before I jump into the message today, I just want to say a thank you, thank you, thank you to everybody. I've received so many cards, so much encouragement. I appreciate all the birthday well wishes. I hit the 65, or I hit the 65, and so anyway, that's always exciting. And there were some people that gave me a couple over-the-hill stuff. And again, I think you have to laugh about getting older, all right? If you don't laugh, you cry. But I was kind of excited to turn 65, all right? But I just want to share with you one of my over 65 gifts, all right? This is the one that it says over the hill bubble bath. And it's a can of Bush's beans. And so if you're not sure what that means, find somebody older on the way out and they'll tell you, all right? So anyway, I thought that was very creative. You won't find this in Walmart, by the way, all right? But you can make up a gift to give somebody. So anyway, I appreciate everything, all the puns, all the encouragement. I tell people, and this is the honest truth, I mean, I feel appreciated 12 months out of the year. This church is one of the most amazing churches ever. And I think every pastor probably feels that way, but it really is true here. And so I love you guys. I just appreciate all the imprint that you have in my heart and my life. So today we're going to finish up our series on the names of God, and this really is my most favorite name, all right? Every time I preach, I say, this is my favorite name, but this one really is my favorite name, all right? And we've been singing about that name most of the morning, and so I think you'll recognize it. In English, it's the name Jesus, and so the Hebrew of that is Yeshua. Everybody say Yeshua. That's the Hebrew. And the Greek is Jesus, Jesus. Everybody say Jesus, all right? And so these are three of the names for Jesus, by the way. So we obviously in the English use Jesus, but in the Hebrew, I don't believe Joseph and Mary said, hey, Jesus, come to lunch. I don't think they called him Jesus because that's an English name. I think they used Yeshua, all right? That's just my opinion. I think he grew up as a Hebrew in the Jewish culture, and I think they probably called him Yeshua. By the way, there were a lot of Yeshuas when Jesus lived, and they even found dozens of caves over in Israel where inscribed were people named Yeshua. So there, it was a very, very common name in the day of Jesus, this name Yeshua, all right? So in the name Jesus, which is our English word for that, is found over 1,000 times in the New Testament. Now, if you look it up in the Greek word is Jesus, all right? And so that's the word that you'll find in the Greek. So if you call him Jesus, call him Jesus, call him Yeshua, I believe it's all the same, all right? So the name means Yahweh saves. His name means Yahweh saves. In the Old Testament, again, the Hebrew would be Yeshua. And if you were to translate Yeshua into English, you would get Joshua, all right? So Joshua, the name Joshua in the Old Testament, has the exact same meaning as the name Jesus, all right? So Joshua is found about 216 times in the Old Testament, and his name means Yahweh saves. All right, so this morning we're going to look at that particular name. But because there are so many people named Yeshua, obviously they had to distinguish this Yeshua from all the other Yeshuas. By the way, the name Jesus in the various languages around the world all are a little bit different, but no matter what language you're speaking it in, it still has power. Now, Elaine from originally from Russia, and I asked her up there on the left, right in the middle there, is the Russian word for Jesus. I said, does that look right? And she said, yes. And so, again, Jesus is called different things in different countries, but again, it's the same person as long as we're addressing God. So how did they distinguish Jesus or Yeshua from all the other Yeshuas? Have you ever thought about in the Bible they would add some names to Jesus? And so one of the names he was referred to as Jesus of Nazareth, all right? So that would distinguish him from all the other Yeshuas that lived during his day. And so the word Nazareth appears 29 times in the Bible, and most of those are connected to Jesus. How many of you ever remember him being called Jesus of Nazareth, all right? So again, that's distinguishing him from the other people named Yeshua. Here in Mark 10, when Bartimaeus heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth that would distinguish him from the others, he knew it was somebody that he wanted to see. He began to cry out and say, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy." But the thing that caught his attention was when they said that, "That's Yeshua of Nazareth." So they knew that it was the right one that he was wanting to speak. By the way, even the demons, interestingly enough, even the demons referred to him as Jesus of Nazareth. The Bible says here in Luke chapter 4, a man with an unclean spirit cried out, "Let us alone! What have we to do with you?" And by the way, this guy was in the synagogue. How many of you think that'd be a creepy Sunday? So Jesus is in church, a guy hollers out, "Let us alone!" I mean, it would have to be one of those weird Sundays. He says, "What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." Even the demons refer to him as Jesus of Nazareth. They knew who he was, the Holy One of God. But yet Jesus did not permit the demons to speak and to share who he was. Another word that's connected to Jesus that again distinguishes him from every other Jesus or Yeshua is the name, as the title Christ. How many of you have ever heard Jesus Christ? All right. So again, the word Christ is found 555 times in the New Testament, and almost every one of those is connected to Jesus. And the word Christ, Christos, means the anointed one. So Jesus is referred to as Yeshua Christ, Christos, the anointed one. All right, so that name is together quite often. One example of that in Romans 1:1, when Paul is writing, Paul says, "A bondservant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated to the gospel." So sometimes he's referred to as Jesus of Nazareth. Sometimes he's referred to as Jesus Christ. But again, it's just kind of distinguishing him from all the other Yeshuas of that day. And sometimes they even combine the two. Here's an example in Acts chapter 3. When Peter was talking to the lame man who had been laid at the temple, he said this, "Silver and gold I do not have, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And so he used both of those, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Have you ever in your prayer time, I mean, sometimes now I find myself praying in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I mean, now, God knows who we're talking about, but every once in a while I still add that in just to throw that out so not only heaven but all of hell would know exactly who we're talking about. I love the scripture in Philippians chapter 2 where Paul says it really is a name above every other name. There is no other name that can compare to Jesus. That's because he humbled himself like nobody's ever been humbled. He came from heaven to earth. He humbled himself to be obedient to the cross and literally was put in a grave. So he humbled himself, and because of that, Paul says God has exalted him and given him a name above every name. Let's read what it says in Philippians 2. Would you join me? "Therefore God also has highly exalted him and given him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in heaven, those on earth, and those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." So Paul says one day every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. I want you to know, and even though in our world there are a lot of people opposed to Jesus, one day the Bible says every knee will bow before God, every tongue will have to confess that Jesus, Yeshua, is Lord. We serve a mighty God. That's why he's been given a name above every name. And I love how Paul says here, whether it's those in heaven, those on earth, or those under the earth, that name has power. That name has clout. Now you go to somebody and say, hey, Satan, I'm a Baptist. And he'll say, big deal. Hey, I go to the Ridge Church. Double big deal. But I'm going to tell you, when you go in the name of Jesus, it has clout, whether it's in heaven, earth, under the earth. The name of Jesus has power. Now, I remember a few years back, several years back, somebody was having, I almost think they were demonic nightmares. I mean, they were just really, really having a problem. They were just having demonic nightmares. They couldn't sleep, and they were just wore out. And so they came to me for some advice. Now, I'm not a counselor. But one thing I know, one good word of advice is Jesus. One thing I know for sure, if they were demonic dreams, what I told them is, hey, I want you to take a Jesus bumper sticker, put it on your headboard. Put a Jesus bumper sticker on the headboard, get a Jesus yard sign, put it over there by your bed. Open your Bible up over the threshold of your door to a passage about Jesus, and I want you just to go to bed tonight saying, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Honestly, within just a short time, they were able to sleep. I'm just telling you, there's something powerful about the name of Jesus. I mean, it's a name, I kind of call it a cosmic credit card. It's good in three worlds. It's good in heaven, it's good on earth, it's good under the earth. And I put Charlie Cobb down here. Is Charlie here? Charlie's not here. Oh, yeah, he is over there. Charlie, up in the balcony. So anyway, I put Charlie, if you remember last week, Charlie Cobb came down, announced he had just given his heart and life to Jesus. Here's a picture of Charlie, 8 years old. Yeah, yeah. So they sent me over a couple pictures of Charlie to pick from. A couple of them had him in Georgia, the Georgia Bulldogs. I skipped those. I don't know why. But anyway, I use this one. I love Charlie. But I want to tell you, 8 years old, when he gives his heart to Jesus, as an 8-year-old, I want to tell you, if he uses the name of Jesus as an 8-year-old, he has clout in heaven, on earth, and under the earth. When you understand that the name of Jesus is a cosmic credit card, and it's not about who you are, it's not about where you go to church, it's not about what your parents did, but it's about what Christ has done. There is power in the name of Jesus. It is good in three worlds. That's why when we pray in Jesus' name, of course. And so every name had a purpose in the Bible. You remember when the angel spoke to Joseph, he said this, she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. Now the complete Jewish Bible, if you have a Jewish Bible, it will say Yeshua. You will call him Yeshua. So again, is Yeshua the right name? Is Jesus the right name? Is Jesus the right name? I would say yes. I have Jewish friends who refer to him as Yeshua. By the way, if you ever go to Israel, they will always know Jesus as Yeshua. All right? So you know that because they're Hebrew. They would know him as Yeshua. It says he will save his people from their sins because the name Jesus, the name Yeshua, the name Jesus all mean the same thing, Yahweh saves. So when you use that name, there's only one name under heaven whereby we must be saved, and that's Jesus. And can I tell you, the world as a whole, my opinion, the world as a whole is tired of pushing denomination. The world as a whole is tired of pushing a particular church or denomination, but the world is never tired of Jesus. And I believe we need to lift Jesus up, and we need to focus on that one thing that draws us all together as believers. That's why when we pray, Jesus taught his disciples to pray in his name. One of his promises, and don't you love, when Jesus talks about prayer, he always uses those big words, whatever, whatsoever you ask. And so it says here in John 14, whatever you ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. That's why when we pray, we say in Jesus' name. We don't come to God based on our performance last week. Whether we've had a good week, a bad week, doesn't matter. But when you come in Jesus' name, He always has a good week. He always is Lord of Lords and King of Kings. So when you come in His name and use that cosmic credit card, it has little to do with who you are and everything to do with who He is. And so the name of Jesus. You know, when they did ministry, they would do it in His name. Here in Mark chapter 9, Jesus said, "No one who works a miracle in my name can soon afterwards speak evil of me." You know, the disciples would say to Jesus, "Jesus, there's someone casting out a demon and they're not following us." And Jesus says, it doesn't matter if they're following you. If they're doing it in my name, they're on our side. And so we got to really make sure we understand. He says, "For whoever gives you a cup of water to drink in my name, because you belong to Christ, assuredly I say to you, he will by no means lose his reward." Something as simple as giving a cup of water in the name of Jesus, he remembers. You know, everything we do should be to lift up Jesus. It's not so that I'm noticed. It's not so that people think I'm somebody. But everything we do should be in his name to lift up the name of Jesus. That's really important. We already mentioned warfare. I love how the 70 came back. Jesus sent them out in Luke chapter 10. It says the 70 returned with joy, saying, "Even the demons are subject to us in your name." I want to tell you, the demons understand the power of the name of Jesus. That's why they want us to talk about everything but Jesus, because they know that you have authority. Even Charlie, 8 years old, has authority as a believer in the name of Jesus. They understand that. By the way, a funny passage in Acts chapter 19, you remember Paul was casting out demons in the name of Jesus, and there were seven sons of Sceva, a Jewish priest, and they said, "You know what? I think we're going to use that name Jesus. That seems to work for Paul." And so they tried to cast a demon out of somebody by the Jesus that Paul preached. That's what it says. So that these unbelievers were using the name of Jesus because they saw Paul using it. And the demons said this to these seven sons. They said, "Paul, we know. Jesus, we know. But who are you?" Can I just say this? You want hell to know your name because you belong to Christ. And I love how the Bible says the demons jumped on those guys and stripped them of all their clothing and they ran out buck naked. That would have been an interesting day at church. Amen? So the name of Jesus in the eyes and the mouth of a believer is powerful. But for an unbeliever, it has no clout. It's only powerful for a child of his who has come to know him as Lord and Savior. I love in Mark chapter 16, as Mark gives his version of the Great Commission, Jesus said, "These signs will follow those who believe. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents. If they drink any deadly thing, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover." Jesus said, "In my name, great things are going to happen." I believe every church really should be ministering in the name of Jesus. And again, it's not about getting people to our church. It's not about promoting the church. It's about promoting Jesus. I think people are still hungry to experience Jesus. I really do. When it came to the multitude after Peter had healed that lame guy in Acts chapter 3, Peter said to the multitude, "It was in his name, through faith in his name, that has made this man strong." Peter said, "It wasn't me. It was in the name of Jesus. By his power did this guy walk." And that's why when we pray for people, we should always pray in Jesus' name. And even if you want to add, in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, we're praying for healing. I mean, I will sometimes pray even in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And so they were disturbed. The Sadducees always got upset because they were teaching and preaching in the name of Jesus. Now, the Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection. They didn't believe in the afterlife. And somebody said that was why they were sad, you see, because they never believed in that. But here in Acts 4, they were all upset because Peter and John were teaching and preaching in Jesus. They were greatly disturbed that they taught the people and they preached in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. And so again, they were very, very bold. And so they were warned. They commanded Peter and John not to speak at all or teach in the name of Jesus. Can I just say to every Sunday school teacher, we should be teaching in the name of Jesus. We should be teaching to lift up Jesus and in the power of that name. But they warned them not to teach or preach in the name of Jesus. And I love their answer when they said, we can't help it. I mean, when you encounter Jesus, you can't help but talk about him. I mean, when you really, by the way, you can go through the Gospels. Every time somebody encountered Jesus and understood who he was, they automatically told people. Even when he told them not to say anything, they couldn't help it. And you find me somebody in love with Jesus, and I'll find you somebody that's going to be sharing everywhere they go. Because it's impossible to love Jesus and not talk about him. Because you're going to want other people to know Jesus as well. And so, again, as I just mentioned, Peter said, we can't help but speak the things we've seen and heard. We got to talk about him. You know, several years ago, there was somebody in our community that was pushing Jesus. Had him on billboards everywhere. How many of you remember the big green billboards with the white letters, the Jesus billboards? Now, I'm just being honest. When I used to go by the Jesus billboards, I thought, man, why green with white letters? It kind of reminded me of Christmas. I don't know why. Why green with white letters? Well, I had the privilege of meeting Brian Brand, who is the one behind the Jesus Name Project. And Brian, I asked Brian, I said, why green with white letters? Why not neon yellow? I like neon yellow. Why not some other color? He said when God kind of put it on his heart to promote the name of Jesus, he said every highway sign, every directional sign on the highway is green with white letters. And he said, I felt like God wanted me to put up the name of Jesus for the ultimate direction in life. I said, I like green with white letters. I really like green with white letters. It's my favorite. It made so much sense. And so I called Brian yesterday. Brian's been at our church a couple times. And I called Brian. I said, hey, you got any stories? I mean, putting up the Jesus billboards. And you got any stories? And I've heard stories personally of one particular guy that was going to go commit suicide. He went by a Jesus billboard. And somehow that name, there's something about that name that he pulled over and he changed his mind. I've heard some unbelievable stories, and Brian shared with me a couple stories. He said, one, there was some guys that would commute to St. Louis, and they came, as they were coming into St. Louis, they would always go by a Jesus billboard. And all the guys in the car were believers except one, and he was a professed atheist. And so every day they drove by the Jesus sign. And finally, one of the guys in the car said to the atheist, what do you think about that sign? And to their amazement, he said, I like it. It's not about promoting a church. It's not about asking for anything. It's about as simple as you can get. It just has the name of Jesus. By the way, he told me he even won an award for one of the best designed billboards. Not anything to it, just Jesus. It's so simple. It's not promoting a church. It's not promoting a denomination. It's not asking for anything. I'm just here to tell you there's something powerful about the name of Jesus. How many of you remember the Jesus yard signs? Anybody here see any Jesus yard signs? Can I tell you where that originated? Right here. I used to go down and see my dad in Farmington. I'd go through Potosi or different ways down there, Herculaneum. There were Jesus yard signs everywhere. It all began here. Actually, there was a guy in our church. His name was J.P. Bridgefort. He lived in Red Barn down here, and he said, I've got a drug house next door to me. J.P. was in his low 30s, had all kinds of physical conditions. But he said, I've got a drug house next to me. And he said, is there any way I could get a yard sign with just Jesus on it? I want to put the yard sign between my driveway and their driveway. And every time somebody comes to buy drugs, I want them to see Jesus. I said, JP, you are radical, man. I love it. So I called Brian, hey, have you ever thought about a yard sign? And he had never thought about it, but he said, let me check into it. And he was able to get the yard signs that were the green, the highway green with the white letters. And we literally have ordered hundreds and hundreds and thousands. And it all started with a young man right over here in Red Barn who came to me and said, I'd love to promote Jesus next to my drug house. By the way, JP passed away. Just really a short time after that. He was in his mid-30s, had all kinds of physical problems. JP passed away, and guess what we put on the inside of his casket, on the inside of the head? We put a Jesus sign. That was buried with him. Because he was the one that had the idea to get a Jesus yard sign. And you know what was really kind of cool? It was in a year of an election. You know how cool it is with all those political signs out there right in the middle to have a Jesus yard sign? That's cool. By the way, somebody used to get those yard signs, and it was somebody in our church, and they told me, I've had 6 of them stolen. Every time I put a new one out, it's gone. Now, surely it's not a Christian stealing it. Did one of you steal it so you could have one for your yard? But anyway, I wouldn't think it'd be a Christian. I wouldn't think an unbeliever would want it. But he said, I did something, Pastor, and they didn't steal it anymore. I said, what'd you do? He said, I got a new one. I stuck it out in my yard, and I wrote on the bottom of it, thou shalt not steal. He said, they didn't take it anymore. That's a tip. You may want to use it. I don't know. By the way, somebody was in the middle service, and they just bought a Jeep. They just bought a Jeep, and they said it came with a bumper sticker on it that said, we speak Jeep. Only Jeep, a couple of you Jeep people, yeah, we know what you're talking about. He goes, you know what? We ought to get a sticker that says, we speak Jesus. That's radical. But Brian Brand, I tell you, nobody, I don't know anybody in our area that has promoted the name of Jesus more than Brian. And then we got radical. We got some banners made and some bumper stickers. There was never a Jesus bumper sticker that I know of, but actually Tim Maxey, that works over at Strotman Feed, who is a member here, they were ordering through a printing company. I said to Tim, can you check on a bumper sticker? We want it with the highway green paint with white letters. And so our church originated all the bumper stickers, and we ordered hundreds and hundreds and thousands, and literally I see them all over the place on the back of people's car. And by the way, if you put it up, I like putting it up on the window because it's up a little bit higher. But how many of you know when you got a Jesus bumper sticker on your car, it affects how you drive? A couple times I forgot. Couple times I got upset and I may have cut somebody off. And I remembered I got the Jesus bumper sticker. By the way, so as you're reading it from the back, now if you have it in the back of your window and you turn around and look at it, it's Jesus backwards. But a crazy thing is if you look through your rear view mirror, which reverses it, when you look through your rear view mirror, it says Jesus. And so every time your blood pressure starts to rise, you look in the rearview mirror, calm down, calm down. So by the way, if you want to give a good gift to somebody who stresses out in traffic, get them a bumper sticker for Christmas. So if you get a bumper sticker for Christmas, your family knows. Your family knows. And they love you. And they care. But these bumper stickers originated here with our church. I consider Brian a good friend. I called him yesterday. He was in a meeting. He answered the phone, said, hey, let me call you on my way back. He was down in Potosi. But we just kind of shared and talked about the name Jesus. I'm just telling you, we serve a mighty God. We serve a God that if we just lift up Jesus, it's not about us. It's just about Jesus. I want to close a couple passages. This is in Acts 4, when they were told not to teach or preach in the name of Jesus. They go back to the church, Peter and John, and they start praying, and they pray that God would give them a boldness. And this was their prayer. Let's read it together. Grant to your servants that with all boldness they may speak your word by stretching out your hand to heal and that signs and wonders be done through the name of your holy servant, Jesus. And so they pray. They say, God, give us a boldness. Stretch out your hand to heal. The signs and wonders are done. And I want to tell you, when you look through the book of Acts, anytime you find a miracle, you'll find the preaching of Jesus. In Acts 3, when that one lame guy was healed, the Bible says thousands gathered together. And when they gathered together, Peter didn't form a healing line. He got up and preached Jesus. And as a result of that one miracle, bringing thousands of people together, Peter preached Jesus, and about that day, the Bible says about 5,000 got saved. How many of you think that's an okay Sunday? I want to tell you, when God's power and God's presence and God's name all get mixed together, great things happen. Now you say, I don't know if I like that prayer. I don't know if I like that prayer. You may not like it, but God did. Because here's what the Bible says happened. When they prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. God liked that prayer. Can I tell you, the early church, man, they rocked their world because they did everything in the name of Jesus, for the name of Jesus, and to his glory. I want us all to stand. We're going to do a Jesus cheer, and then we're going to have a song. The song is, I Speak Jesus. But we're going to do a Jesus cheer first. We haven't done it for a while. I've been doing these since I was a young pastor. I had the privilege of going to Belleville, Illinois to do a revival back when I was about 23 years old. I was young. Guess who the pastor at Belleville, Illinois was? Ron Heimer. How many of you know Ron? Ron's a member here now. Well, Ron was a pastor there. I went as doing a youth revival because one of my friends, Andy, was the youth pastor there. And I said to Ron, by the way, I said, Ron, do you remember me? He said, not really. That hurt. I pretty much have that impression. You don't really remember me. But by the way, whether you remember my name is not a big deal. But whether you remember Jesus is everything. But I remember the last night of the revival, I told Andy, I said, I think we're going to do a Jesus cheer tonight. I think we're going to do a Jesus cheer. Now, Belleville was kind of a high church. It was an uppity-up, some well-to-do. You know what kind of church I'm talking about? It was kind of uppity-up. And there was one lady who sat on the second pew right over here that was very proper. Everything was proper. And he said to me, this one lady, man, if you do a Jesus cheer, I am done here. I said, I'm going to risk it, Andy. I'm going to risk it. But I got up that night and I said, hey, this is no reflection on Andy. It's no reflection on the church. I'm just doing a Jesus cheer, and if you don't like me, I'm out of here tonight. And so I got them all up. I said, man, I want you to do a Jesus cheer. I want you to put your fist up in the air. And guess who cheered the loudest? She about came out of her shoes. Who would have ever thought this little, sweet, loving, proper believer would come out of her shoes to shout Jesus. I found out a long time ago, inside of all of us, we want to lift up that name. So here we go. The only way I know how to do it, just like high school, give me a J.
J.
All right, that's not bad. That's not bad. That was a 9:30 cheer, but we got to go 10:50. All right. Now, whatever your best, I'm just asking you to give me your best. I don't want you to punch out, but up. All right, make sure you go up. I want you to give me the best you have. If you're not a hand raiser, just do it at the wrist. All right, just nobody will see you. If you're not a shouter, just grunt. Just grunt Jesus. Just give me the best you got. But I don't want to see you at the ball game. Woo! Woo! Go Sally! And then not be able to shout in church. You guys ready? I sense something good's going to happen right here. All right? We want to lift up the name to heaven, earth, and under the earth. All right, here we go. Give me a J.
J.
That was really good. Give me an E.
E.
Give me an S.
S.
Give me a U.
U.
Give me an S.
S.
What's it spell?
Jesus.
I can't hear you.
Jesus.
Who's Lord of Lords?
Jesus.
Who's King of Kings?
Jesus.
Who's worthy of all of our praise?
Jesus.
The Bible says there's no other name given under heaven whereby we must be saved. In the name of Jesus. So we're going to sing this song. This is the best part. You guys get the best part of the service. The song is called I Speak Jesus. So you guys jump in and let's sing along and just celebrate. And then right after the song, we're going to have communion together. Let's sing together and celebrate the privilege of speaking that name.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. Just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus.
Jesus in the darkness over every enemy.
Did anybody here not get a communion cup and you would like to celebrate with us? If you don't mind, just keep your hands up. There's a couple right up here on the front, several right over here. Anybody else not get a communion cup and you would like to participate? I believe the Bible teaches we're each to examine our own heart, so I believe it's an individual choice if you're a born-again believer. If you have a cup, if you'll turn it juice down and just kind of peel that back and then take the cracker out, and then you can turn it back juice up and then peel back the tab on that. And so in just a moment, we're going to take both the cracker and the cup together. I believe it's a time, as they did on that first night, the Bible says Jesus gave thanks. So I think it's a time, first of all, to give thanks to God for such an incredible gift. It's a time to look back to Calvary and remember that God loved us. He humbled himself. He came down, took on an earth suit. He died on the cross so that you and I could go to heaven. Wow. And so part of what we're doing is looking back, celebrating that gift. But the Bible says we're also to look forward, and we're to do it until he comes back. So we're also declaring one day Jesus is coming again. Paul said we're to look within, we're to examine ourselves. And so I hope you'll take a moment, examine yourself. But I also believe the Bible teaches we're to look around and to celebrate the body of Christ. I am so thankful to be a part of a body. And so as we take communion today, I just want it to be a celebration of Jesus, a celebration of our love for each other, our love for the Lord. And on that first night, Jesus said, as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do it in remembrance of me. So let's look up before we eat and drink and just say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And if you can, on your way out today, if you'll take these and just drop them in the trash can, it's great to be able to worship together. I hope every day this week, I hope at least one day, once a day, that we have the opportunity to share Jesus with somebody. You'd be surprised how many people are waiting to hear that name. Bob's going to share, and then we're going to close. God bless you.
Hey, we're getting ready to sing our way out of here. Been a great morning. Amen. Three things to remember. Remember, pray about how the Holy Spirit would lead you in the Operation Christmas Child boxes, okay? So we have boxes back here for you to grab. If he wants you to grab one, if he wants you to grab three, great. Grab those on the way out the door. Along with that, grab a list. It'll show you what to pack and what not to pack. You can grab a label for the gender and age that you'd like to pack for. It's a great opportunity to be able to go to Dollar Tree, wherever it may be, with your kids and your grandkids. Pack that around your kitchen table, knowing that in a handful of weeks, a child somewhere around the world with the gospel in their heart language is going to open that box. It's going to be an incredible thing to do. So be praying. Take that. Secondly, say Saturday.
Saturday.
Say Saturday. 11 a.m. in the gym, we're having a church-wide packing party. Now, here's what that means. Church-wide packing party is not bring your box to church and pack it here. You'll bring your box here after you pack it at home, right? But the church-wide packing party is about a lot of people have been buying things all year long. We're trying to pack at least 300 boxes. We need some extra hands. It's a great time, a lot of fun, even some pizza. It'll be from 11 to 3 in the gym this coming Saturday, okay?
Please, would you have mercy? Just 2 more minutes. The story of Elena Nicholson goes beyond what she told you. She didn't tell you the remainder of what happened in her life, praying to a God she did not know. A Christian family adopted them, brought them here, living like the Taj Mahal, like she'd never lived before, and got to go to college, met a Christian young man, and her dream was, I want to go back to that orphanage and help them have running water, because all they had was a pan of water once a week to wash with. So she collected $5,000, and that's what she had gone around to do, to collect this money so she could go back and get them some water, and her husband and her helped get the money together, but they collected $20,000. She said, so what I really want to do, she says, I want to get some Bibles in the Russian language. So over to the orphanage, she takes the money for the water that they could have, they've never had, and the Russian Bibles for all these little orphans. That's not the end of the story. 2 weeks later, she came home, she got word from the orphanage director saying, Soviet Union has closed the doors, no more Bibles. Is that not a God thing? 8 years old, and look what she has done. One box of love of Jesus, you know. I just want you to know that the story doesn't end at the beginning there. There's more to the ending to this, and the discipleshiping and what each child learns, what they do, where they go, and how they spread the gospel to many, many more people. So, and we need that now in this country more than we've ever needed it before. And our children are going to be running this country 10 years from now. What have we got? What have we done? So, anyway.
Amen. Amen. So let's give the Lord a hand for that. Amen. Isn't that incredible? So, one last thing very quickly. We're doing a coat drive the next 2 weeks. Next 2 weeks. So bring in coats. If you have new coats or lightly used coats, getting ready to get cold outside, right? Especially for children. We need those. So begin to bring those in, and you'll see a place in the fellowship hall to leave those. Love you guys. What a great church. And it's just because it's a great God. Amen. So we give him all the glory, but we sure love you guys. Let's sing our way out of here. God bless you.
Your name is